Think about it. Omar wears a hijab, which according to the Quran 33:59 tells women to cover so they won't get molested. Is her adherence to this Islamic doctrine indicative of her adherence to Sharia law, which in itself is antithetical to the United States Constitution?
Let's discuss this with Brian Stelter, CNN chief media correspondent and anchor of Reliable Sources, and John Avalon, CNN senior political analyst. Brian, this did not surprise me when I worked at Fox. Sharia law was one of their favorite boogeymen.
Yes.
Roger Ailes was very exercised about Sharia law. And so there, we did a lot of segments on Sharia law. None of them were fact-based, or they didn't, there was no emphasis on them being fact-based.
They were fear-based.
And so I hear that language. That's familiar old language. Yeah. And I guess the only thing that is surprising is that Fox put out a statement condemning Jeanine Pirro. I mean, it took them 24 hours to get around to it. So after 24 hours of, I guess, outcry online, Fox put out a statement saying, "We strongly condemn Jeanine Pirro's comments about Representative Ilhan Omar. They do not reflect those of the network, and we have addressed the matter with her directly."
I think there could be two reasons why Fox issued that statement. Number one, it could be advertiser pressure, advertisers wanting to pull out. Number two, it could be staff pressure. Internally, staffers, including one who works on Brett Baer's show, who is Muslim, spoke out against Pirro and said, "Why are you spreading this false narrative that Muslims hate America?" If I could speak to Pirro, if she happens to be watching, I would say, "What are you so afraid of? What are you so scared of? All of these lawmakers, Muslims in America, people of many faiths, people of many backgrounds, they're all trying to make America better. What are you so afraid of?" But the Fox narrative for years has been about fear of Muslims, fear of minorities.
Well, I mean, what they're so afraid of is ratings dipping.
Look, this isn't, I don't want to call it ignorance, because ignorance implies that she doesn't know better. But I guarantee you, Jeanine Pirro knows the truth here. So it's not ignorance, it's just hate.
This was also written in the teleprompter.
And it's hate, that's my point. It's hate in teleprompter.
Right, and I think that's worse, because it's not a slip up, it's intentional. But of course, this all gets filed under the, I learned it from you, Dad, because you're saying all members of Congress, love America. But Donald Trump, of course, the other weekend said members of Congress hate America. And you know, folks got to stop getting on the soapbox and calling themselves a constitutional conservative without having a passing understanding of what the Constitution actually says. And this is Exhibit A. The default to fear-mongering, say Roger Ailes got exercised. I like the verb choice on that one. But this is a fundamental problem of the fear-mongering that has passed for too long. And the fact they asked you to correction is actually surprising, because usually it's only been in reaction to advertiser boycotts. And there's not any evidence of that as far as.
Yeah, I think maybe this was internal staff pressure.
Well, and
maybe the Murdochs they look at this and they say, don't go and be so blatant. Don't be so obvious about your fear mongering and maybe that's the issue, is that they prefer to subtext sometimes.
Well, I mean, to that end, I do think that we should via Twitter read the producer on Brett Baer's, one of the producers on Brett Baer's show, who put this out. I mean, who obviously felt so offended by what Jeanine had said. He says, "Jeanine Pirro, can you stop spreading this false narrative that somehow Muslims hate America or women who wear a hijab are not American enough? You have Muslims working at the same network you do, including myself." Okay? Thanks.
Yeah. Good on her.
Brave. Yeah.
Right.
Absolutely.
That's number one. The idea here that Fox is surprised by this, I agree with you, Allison, that this is something that's been going on for a very long time at Fox. But right now, Fox is trying to do two things. It's trying to counter this narrative presented in The New Yorker last week, that it's a propaganda network for the president. And it's trying to promote its news brand. It's out there to advertisers promoting its news programs. So where are the news anchors on Fox saying, "I don't want to work in this kind of place. This is unacceptable. Jeanine Pirro should not be allowed to be on this network reading this script that she's written that's been put in the teleprompter"? Where are those news anchors today?
They might be thinking about how they're going to respond to Tucker Carlson. Recordings and transcripts of radio interviews he did. Let's just play a little bit. And my apologies to Justice Elena Kagan, because what he says about the Supreme Court justice is offensive. But listen to this.
"You don't think she's that hot?
Come on. I would have sexual relations with her.
I've got to be honest with you. I don't like her, and I wouldn't vote to confirm her if I were a U.S. senator. But I do feel sorry for her in that way. I feel sorry for unattractive women. I mean, there's nothing they did."
That's Tucker Carlson, host of Fox's show at 8 o'clock at night. Is Fox going to ask Tucker to apologize?
We shall see. He released a statement saying that he was caught saying something naughty. But I think the full context of his comments, and he's calling into this shock jock show, Bubba the Love Sponge, and that may be part of his defense. But this goes well beyond something naughty. I mean, the comment about Elena Kagan is crass and clueless and callous, and perhaps an indication of how he would vote if he was in the U.S. Senate. But his comments about Warren Jeffs and the child bride marrying in certain cults, I mean, that to me is even a starker example. And I don't think that can be simply excused away unless we're embracing a new era of normalization. I think that's a more serious thing that goes beyond humor.
He calls women primitive, too.
Yes, many.
I mean,
Media Matters is an anti-Fox group that dug up this old audio, but he's not denying the audio. The audio is real. These clips are real. There's many of them. They're misogynistic. They're perverse. And instead of apologizing, what he says is, hey, watch my show. Come on my show. Debate me. I mean, he's trying to turn this into a ratings ploy, when, in fact, it's more evidence that some of these hosts on Fox engage in shock jock behavior all the time.
Just a couple things. I mean, this is not the Tucker that I know.
That's right.
I worked with Tucker for many years. This is not the person that I know. But this is also not old audio. I just want to be clear. It's from 2006. In
2011,
misogynism and sexism was not in favor then in 2006. That's and right. Saying stuff about young girls, it just wasn't in favor then. So I know that you know, when you're on a shock jock show, you can try to be outrageous, but this is beyond.
The gravitational pull goes, and Tucker can be a charming guy, but there's also the question of applying standards and saying what is too far and not buying into the normalization.
This was out loud.
Yeah.
It was on the radio. He's not apologizing. He's promoting his show for tonight. That should tell you everything.
You got it.
Brian, right. John, appreciate it.
Thank you very much. We do have some breaking details for you on the Ethiopian plane crash. New Day continues right now.
This is CNN Breaking News.
All right, good morning, everyone. Welcome to your new day. It's Monday, March 11th, 8 o'clock in the East, and we do begin with breaking news. Investigators have now recovered the cockpit voice and data recorders of the Ethiopian Airlines plane that crashed, killing all 157 people on board, including 8 Americans. Boeing facing intense scrutiny this morning. Several countries and airlines around the world, they are grounding the company's 737 MAX 8 aircraft.
So pressure is now growing on U.S. carriers to decide whether they're going to ground this fleet. And it isn't just any aircraft. This is Boeing's best-selling passenger jet with hundreds in service here in the U.S. and thousands in service around the world. CNN is the only network that is live at the crash site in Ethiopia. Our David McKenzie is there with all of the breaking details. Tell us what you're seeing happening around you, David.
John Ellison, good morning. It's a terrible scene behind me. The digger has just started up again, trying to move the earth in this crater where the airline crashed into this hillside on Sunday here in Ethiopia. This brand new Boeing 737-8 MAX. Now, the latest information is, as you say, the flight data recorder, the audio cockpit recorder were recovered just a short time ago from the scene. There was a lot of commotion around those crucial devices that could provide clues as to why this brand new plane, just a few minutes after takeoff, then crashed into the side of the mountain where I'm standing. We briefly spoke to the U.S. ambassador who was on the scene here looking to make sure that everything was secured. There is a NTSB team coming in overnight, he said. He said that Interpol is working with the U.S. officials and Ethiopians to try and identify the bodies that are being brought out over time through this day that we've been watching this recovery effort. Just tragic scenes. They've also trying to take the personal effects that they find, particularly handbags or backpacks of people, to see if they can find any IDs to try and give some kind of solace to the loved ones as we move forward. But right now, it will be shock. And across the world, there's an impact of this crash because China has grounded all of its similar airlines, as well as an Indonesian airline, and here, of course, in Ethiopia. This airline has an excellent safety record. It is also has one of the newest fleets on the continent. So the questions will be mounting about Boeing and whether there is any issue with this plane. No evidence yet of that and no clear indication of just what happened here and what has caused all these horrible scenes to be playing out behind me. Allison, John.
David McKenzie, it's so good to have you there on the ground to see those efforts behind you. Thank you so much for your reporting. Let's bring in CNN aviation analyst and science correspondent for PBS NewsHour, Miles O'Brien, and CNN anchor and correspondent Richard Quest. Richard, two crashes, brand new aircraft, same exact model in less than 5 months, perfect weather in both cases. You say this is a full-blown crisis for Boeing.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. There's no doubt about that. It's not just they just were two new, brand new planes. It was the phase of flight when it took place within the first 10, 12 minutes. There are similarities in the fluctuations in altitude. In both cases, the pilots asked to turn back and declared that they were having problems. Now, I'm very well aware that you can't just say one and one and therefore that it makes two. I mean, you've got to sort of have more to it than that. But now the Chinese have decided to ground the MAX fleet, and the Ethiopians and the Indonesians, for the traveling public, this is an almost impossible situation, because you've got US carriers and European carriers saying, we have confidence in the fleet, and the Chinese regulator saying, well, maybe you do, maybe you don't, but frankly, we're grounding them until we know.
Miles, after the Lion Air crash, which was just 8 months ago, and again, in very similar circumstances, Boeing sent out an emergency bulletin, basically saying pilots needed to retrain to use this new equipment. Does that seem to you to be a likely cause of this?
Well, I will say this, John, that every pilot who put his or her hands on the controls of a 737 MAX 8 would have been very familiar with what happened to Lion Air and would have thought about what they would do in that situation. What's interesting about this scenario, hauntingly parallel to the Lion Air crash, is that things happen so quickly and in such a dynamic fashion, so close to the ground. So even a pilot who had taken the time to read that airworthiness directive, and any good pilot would, of course, when the chips are down, when you're in that moment fighting this automated system designed to improve safety, but perhaps actually making things worse, when you're in that moment, if you do the right thing in short order, is a difficult thing.
Explain to me what the automated system, that automatic control, would do, and why pilots need special training to know how to counteract it.
Well, so when they built this new model of the 737, they put bigger engines on, more fuel-efficient engines, and they moved them forward. So what that did was it changed the control properties of the aircraft. It made it tend to pitch up more. So what they did was they basically put some software into the system to make it harder for that situation to occur. It's called angle of attack, nose high attitude. If you get too high, there's an aerodynamic stall. So that was the system that was put in place. Pilots were really unaware of it, and that's a source of some contention and concern inside the airline industry. But the fact is, there is a procedure to disable that system in a pinch. But if you're in a situation where the aircraft is violently headed toward the ground at high speed, you don't have a lot of time to deal with it.
And if you don't have the training and aren't ready for it, it can get you by surprise. Richard Quest, anecdotally, we're hearing from people asking us, does the plane I'm flying on today, does my American plane, is it a 737 MAX 8? We're hearing about people going to websites to check it out. Mary Schiavo, who was on with us before, said it might be reasonable, it would be reasonable, to ground this type of aircraft until they know for sure what's going on.
Whatever the reasonableness of the position, the traveling public's confusion will only be enhanced by this discrepancy. You cannot have the Chinese, which has got a huge fleet of aircraft and 95 MAX 8s in the fleet, you cannot have the Chinese regulator saying we're going to ground them. Meanwhile, every US airline is putting out statements saying we have confidence in the plane and we have confidence in everything. The two are inconsistent. The aviation industry should speak with one voice when it comes to safety and security. It doesn't always, but the traveling public shouldn't be caught in the middle. And that's why I think by tonight, you're going to see some sort of clarity one way or the other, because you simply cannot, or should not maybe, have this discrepancy of authorities determining the safety or the reliability of an aircraft.
And Miles, just to put a fine point on it, generally speaking, in perfect weather like this with a brand new aircraft, this shouldn't happen.
Modern aircraft like this simply should not fall out of the clear blue sky. And the fact that it's happened in a hauntingly parallel fashion in a matter of months, I think puts the burden of proof on Boeing to prove this is a safe aircraft. And I think the prudent thing to do is to ground these aircraft. I mean, now that they've discovered the black boxes, we should have an insight into what happened fairly quickly, and fast action should be taken.
Richard, you want a quick last word?
I mean, not often, Miles, and I fully agree, but fully agree. I mean, he said it more clearly than I could. It's time to seriously think about grounding the fleet as an abundance of caution.
Two major crashes in less than 5 months, 157 people killed in this one, 189 in the first. Richard Quest, Miles O'Brien, thanks for helping us understand what's happening this morning. Appreciate it. Welcome.
So my family and I are flying this weekend. I've already been online trying to figure out if this is the plane. It would make it a lot more calming for me and everybody who is flying right now and this week if they would just ground this fleet until they figure it out. I mean, as Mary said, they're going to have the answer by the end of this week. So it's not that long that we're asking for them to be taken.
American, United, and Southwest all fly this plane. There are dozens in service. I will say, chances are American pilots have gone through, U.S. pilots have gone through the training that might be the issue here.
I agree, but I don't even like the idea of the pilot having to override the automated system while it's bucking, while the plane is bucking. Even that's nerve-wracking.
They got to investigate. They got to get to the bottom this fast.
All right. Now... his proposed border wall, setting up a new budget battle with Democrats. This amount is much more than the president's initial ask last year, which Congress rejected. Joining us now is David Gregory, a CNN political analyst, Jackie Kucinich, Washington bureau chief at the Daily Beast, and also a CNN political analyst, and Laura Baron Lopez, national political reporter at Politico. David Gregory, this is just political theater, right? I mean, this is just a messaging exercise because Congress has already rejected this, as we all remember, just a few weeks ago.
Right. It's definitely theater. It's a hedge for the president who is going to be defeated on this emergency declaration and may hope for some support in the courts. But if he doesn't do that, he still wants to assert his priorities. I mean, budget documents are no more than wish lists now. We haven't passed a budget in a long time around here. So as a result, this is a president saying this is still something that I care about, defeat or no defeat. This is what I stand for. And the wall, by the way, is simply campaigning by metaphor. It is just a way of saying I'm going to be tough on the border. I'm going to make sure that my voters understand that they should be afraid of people coming from the southern border. And that's what I'll campaign on. Fear, as I did in 2016. He'll do it again in 2020. At the same time, I think it's worth noting two things. One, he could have had this wall if he had done a larger agreement on immigration. Two, he's telling some of these same supporters, oh, the wall's already being built. I'm already succeeding. At the same time, he's asking for so much more to complete it. So he's got a lot of different messages here, all part of the theater.
You know, Jackie, it's interesting because before the midterm elections, there were Republicans who were surprised and unhappy that the president was leaning in to immigration when he had other issues that Republicans wanted to run on. Those same Republicans were surprised when he leaned into the shutdown, when there were other things that Republicans wanted to deal with. And now he's saying, I'm going to lean into immigration all the way into November 2020.
Yep, and they better snuggle in and not be surprised this time, because the president has seen that this has been a winning issue for him in the past. We'll see if he can replicate that again in 2020. But this isn't going anywhere, regardless. And that's the X factor when you look at how the president is building this massive campaign structure going into 2020. What the president is going to focus on, because his campaign and Republicans writ large are going to have to follow that messaging, whether they like it or not, either rejecting it or embracing it. So we can just expect more and more of this, and the more he kind of goes up against Congress, he hopes that he will reap the political benefit of that from his base, who this issue matters the most to.
Laura, the deficit and debt, meanwhile, are exploding. Do you remember when Republicans were very concerned about this? I remember the talking point of the debt that you would be crushing your grandchildren with, that it would be ruining the country. And these are some of the same people who are now the president's top advisors. And the idea that the deficit has ballooned under him doesn't seem to be spoken about now.
Right. No, it hasn't fazed Republicans at all. I mean, they've completely thrown at that talking point, and they fully embrace the president's agenda, and they fully have embraced his talking points about the border wall. And so I think you can expect Republicans to say that they are behind this $8.6 billion that the president is now requesting. But again, we have to remember that Democrats control the House now. It's not a one-party rule anymore the way it was when last year Trump was trying to get some $25 billion for the wall last January, and that didn't even work when all of Republicans controlled all of Congress. So now with Democrats in charge, you can expect Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer to say no to this money.
So Democrats control the House. They want to control more than that. Namely, they want to control the White House as well. And Laura, we have a new poll out with the Des Moines Register of what Iowa voters want to see in the Democratic primary. And Joe Biden is leading that field right now. 27%, 25% for Bernie Sanders. Now, Joe Biden continues to top these polls, Laura. And people say, oh, it's just name recognition. It's just name ID. Well, I'm old enough to remember not just deficits, but also the 2016 race where Donald Trump led in Republican primary polling for a long time. And people just dismissed it as, oh, well, they know him from The Apprentice. Sooner or later, that bubble will burst. Maybe the Biden bubble won't burst.
You're right. I mean, maybe it won't. Biden is definitely a formidable candidate, and that is why as soon as he jumps in, which many expect that he will, he's going to shake up the entire field. He's going to be right up at the front with Sanders. But I think there's two interesting points in the poll that came out this weekend, which if you're a rival Democratic candidate, if you're Kamala Harris or Booker or Elizabeth Warren, you're going to be looking at. And that's that 31% of Iowa Democrats said that Biden's time has passed, and 41% said that Sanders has passed. So that's why that's what rival Democrats are going to be looking at. And they're hoping that there's room enough in those numbers for stuff to change as the caucuses approach.
I agree with that. But I also think that Biden occupies his own lane right now, which is a more establishment, older Democrat, not just age, but older in terms of longevity within the party and among older caucus goers, where you see he's got an advantage. Bernie Sanders at the moment has that advantage among younger caucus goers. And he now shares a lane with a lot of candidates who are running for the first time, who are trying to take that progressive mantle away from him. And that, of course, is going to be the big challenge for Biden, which he is not going to be known as a progressive. There's no doubt the party would have to pull him left quite a bit. But he is still going to occupy not just the name recognition, but the person that Democrats look up and say, oh, yeah, he could be president. He could restore America's standing in the world. He could take on Trump. He could speak to working class voters. There's a level of certainty that people will project onto him while there's still questions about others who are more progressive in the party.
But, you know, that longevity is going could be a blessing and a curse for Joe Biden. He hasn't been vetted in a climate where his words could come back to haunt him. We're talking about the crime bill. We're talking about that Anita Hill video, which is really shocking. And when you watch that now, knowing with the Kavanaugh hearing so fresh in everyone's mind. So how Joe Biden will stand up to that sort of vetting, that is an open question at this point.
And then Laura Beto, O'Rourke is deciding this week, we think.
That's right.
We think.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, Beto could also shake up the race. I know from a number of members of Congress that are from states where other 2020 candidates are running, from California and New York, that they're waiting on Beto. He has a lot of strong relationships within the House, and that could help him as he gets his campaign running. It's the same with Biden, though. You know, there are a number of House members who have known him for a long time, and they're going to be excited when he jumps in.
That goes to your point, John, which is that one of the reasons that Trump survived that field is that it was such a huge field, right? And you have to wonder whether Biden can enjoy something similar, which is how fractured the field could be.
I actually had heard from Biden people back in January, which either feels like 100 years ago or not that long ago, that one of the things that kept on making the race more attractive was that there were so many people in, because what you need to win in a 20-person race may be 19 or 20%, which is achievable. Right. David Gregory, Laura, Jackie, thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
All right, President Trump is asking a now-divided Congress for billions of dollars in border wall money. How will that go ever? A Democratic member of Congress.
Yes.
President Trump shows no signs of giving up on his border wall. Today, the president will ask Congress for another $8.6 billion to pay for it as part of his new budget request. Joining me now is Democratic Senator Doug Jones from Alabama. He's also the author of Bending Toward Justice, about the decades-long struggle to bring justice or deliver justice for the victims of the 1963 Birmingham church bombing. Senator, thanks so much for being with us.
It's my pleasure.
You know, before I ask you questions about today, there was a tornado, those terrible tornadoes that struck Alabama, your home state, last week. How's the recovery effort?
I think it's going great. When I was down there 3 or 4 days afterwards, and it was amazing what the first responders had done, how they were cleaning up. Everyone has stepped up. EMA, the churches, the faith community, everyone has stepped up. The hospital did an extraordinary job in a matter of hours dealing with all this. And our the porch band of Indians has stepped up, and they are paying for all of the funerals, because it's a very poor area of Alabama. So everyone has stepped up in an amazing way.
It's going to take a big effort to recover.
Oh, absolutely.
So I'm glad we had a chance to ask you about that. Let me ask you about the president's request for more than $8 billion for the border wall funding. Is this real, or is this just Washington theater at this point? He's begging for a fight.
Well, you know, I hope we'll do this. His budget has been kind of a moving target on the border. What I'm hoping is he will submit this, and then we can have some hearings on it. Mm-hmm. Let's get this out in the open. One of the biggest criticisms of the president's ask has been that we haven't seen what he really wants and let the experts talk about it in a hearing. So we'll see how it goes. I think it's part of the budgetary process where you ask and then you negotiate. What I'd really like to see is some regular order with Senator Shelby and Senator Leahy with a hearing, and let's talk about it.
But this may be regular order. This request is
absolutely
could be part of that. But you're not one of these Democrats who's going to say no new money for a border wall at all?
Well, because every time I talk to people about a border wall, they really just want border security.
Okay.
I mean, that is clear they want better border security, and there's a lot of ways to do that. If we can get some hearings and get the experts in, I think we can come up with whatever is necessary to secure that border.
All right. You are a working lawyer. You've been a lawyer for a long time, and a successful one. I want to get your take on what House Intelligence Chair Adam Schiff says that he wishes Robert Mueller did. He wishes Mueller actually had gone the distance and tried to put the president before a grand jury. Listen to this.
Yes, I think it is a mistake, and I've said all along that I don't think Bob Mueller should rely on written answers. I think the constraint that Bob Mueller is operating under is he had an acting attorney general who was appointed because he would be hostile to a subpoena on the president. And now he has a permanent attorney general who was chosen for the same hostility to his investigation, who would likely oppose that step.
Was it a mistake for Robert Mueller not to get the president under oath to testify before a grand jury?
I can't say that it was a mistake. I'm sure he tried and wanted to. But, you know, I've been a prosecutor before. I was a U.S. attorney. So you can't always get potential targets or subjects in front of a grand jury and get them under oath. And the president's legal team was going to resist that mightily and would have just delayed the process. I got a lot of confidence in Mueller and the special counsel and their team to understand where they are, what they need to do, and what can be completed for his investigation.
Enough confidence that if, and I know it's a hypothetical, if this report comes back and says there was no collusion that we found between the president or his associates with Russia, we didn't find it, will then you say, okay, time to move on?
Well, I'll say on that particular report, for sure, I've said from the very beginning, we need to go where the evidence leads it and accept the conclusions. I mean, I think most folks that know Bob Mueller know that he is going to do an incredibly thorough job. And if there are things there that can be uncovered, he's going to uncover them. But that doesn't always lead to where a lot of people in the political world want him to lead. So we'll see how that goes. But I'm going to accept those conclusions because I believe he will have had the opportunity to do a very, very thorough job.
Do you worry that all all Democrats will not accept those conclusions, though?
Well, there's always going to be people that are not going to accept the conclusion, just like if he comes up and says there is collusion, that there are going to be a lot of Republicans that are not going to accept that. We live in a political world, but I think when you go through the facts and you look what Mueller's done, and remember, there's much more to the Mueller investigation than simply whether or not there was some collusion. What he is looking at is absolutely how the Russians, communist Russia, have interfered in our elections. We've already got two major indictments. So there's going to be a lot of information that comes out of this
report. That is already done. All right, Judge Roy Moore, you beat him in a special election to take the Senate seat you're in now. He is making the motions perhaps to run again. What would you say if he jumped back in?
I'm not worried about who's running in my race in 2020. We're focused on the same things that we focused on the last time, the kitchen table issues, the issues that mean so much to people. There will be a lot of people that run for that. What's really kind of comical to me is watch the reaction of the Republicans who all supported him a couple of years ago, and now they're talking about he's a flawed candidate and yada, yada, yada. So I just think it's kind of comical to watch these days. But we'll be ready for whoever the nominee is next spring.
I want to ask you about your book, and I love the title, Bending Toward Justice. Of course, the Martin Luther King quote, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice." It's about the work you did in the case stemming from the Birmingham church bombing. Right. What's the major lesson you learned from that?
There are a lot of lessons I think learned. I think that as we look back now, I think the biggest lesson is to go back in and re-examine yourselves and where we were as a society at that point under the Jim Crow laws in the South and other places too. This just wasn't just segregation was just not limited to the South during those times. And also, listen to what we're doing now, and we're sliding back on voting rights. We're sliding back on civil rights. In today's world, civil rights means more than just an issue between black and white. It involves race. It involves religion. It involves gender. And we need to be careful. Words matter. And I think that there was a part of that in this, in the book, that we talked about the fact that, you know, people like Governor Wallace and Bull Connor really empowered people to do things that they might not otherwise do. And I'd like to make sure that everybody has a discussion. I do think we need to have discussions about where we are in this country on race and other issues.
When you say words matter, obviously, there are words that are used now in our public discourse in language that is used that really hasn't been used ever.
That's correct. And we talk about the president and some of his words, but I think we have to be very careful on both sides of the political aisle because it really makes a difference. People are listening. And in today's world, in our social media world, where more people have their phones and they're watching and listening in the privacy in their own home, and we tend to stay in these silos. We really need to have more dialogues and discussions and to be a lot more civil to each other and to work across the aisles to kind of get things done. I think that's what the American people really want.
Senator Jug Jones, the book is